I'm continuing my reading. What I'm doing in this series is to read through the entire standard works of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. This consists of the Bible, the Book of Mormon, the Doctrine and Covenants, and the Pearl of Great Price. I am reading in a chronological order of events, not according to publication or volume, so I will be skipping around a bit as I move along. Right now, I am reading the last chapter in the second Book of Samuel. This is chapter 24, right at the end of David's life. These are his last acts. So he's put down the rebellion of Absalom, his son, and now we have the last few years of his life. Let us read this. Chapter 24. David sins in numbering Israel and Judah. The men of war total 1,300,000. The Lord destroys 70,000 men by pestilence. David sees an angel, offers sacrifice, and the plague is stayed. Before I read any more, though, I have to mention that I actually read this chapter once already. My original plan was to have it released before 1 Chronicles chapter 21, which tells the same story. However, my recording got corrupted, and I have to redo it. So that's what I am doing now. My video in 1 Chronicles makes reference back to 2 Samuel, so I apologize that they're being released in reverse order of what the original plan was, but anyways, let us read. And again the anger of the Lord was kindled against Israel, and he moved David against them to say, "Go, number Israel and Judah." Let's pause. I know it's only one verse, but we have this in the footnotes. Apparently something is missing, and Satan should be the antecedent of he. So it said, instead of and he moved David against them, it should say, and Satan moved David against them. We saw this in 1 Chronicles chapter 21, where Satan is given the credit. It is Satan that is inspiring David to do this, not God. And God is displeased with David for doing this. Let us continue. Verse 2. For the king said to Joab, the captain of the host which was with him, "Go now through all the tribes of Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, and number ye the people, that I may know the number of the people." And Joab said unto the king, "Now the Lord thy God add unto the people, how many soever they be, an hundredfold, and that the eyes of my lord the king may see it. But why doth my lord the king delight in this thing?" Notwithstanding, the king's word prevailed against Joab and against the captains of the host. And Joab and the captains of the host went out from the presence of the king to number the people of Israel. So why is this such a bad thing? Why is God displeased? Why is Joab arguing against this? It sounds like David's just taking a census, right? It doesn't clarify it really in the scriptures, but it is assumed that what David is doing is he is taking a tally of his military force. He is preparing a new military campaign, and he wants to know how many soldiers he can muster. And Joab and the rest of the captains of the host are all saying, "This is a bad idea. We shouldn't be doing this." David's already conquered all the land that Israel's supposed to have, and he has subdued all of his neighbors so that they are vassal states where they're paying tribute to David. He doesn't need to do any more. And doing more is kind of going against what God promised to Israel. And so these men are saying, "We don't want to do this," but David, being king, he just, you know, as he says, his word prevailed, meaning he was king, and so they did it anyways, even though they objected. So, verse 5, "And they passed over Jordan, and pitched in Aroer, on the right side of the city that lieth in the midst of the river Gad, and toward Jazer. Then they came to Gilead, and to the land of Tatim Hotshai, and they came to Danjan, and about to Zidon, and came to the stronghold of Tyre, and to all the cities of the Hivites, and of the Canaanites. And they went out to the south of Judah, even to Beersheba. So when they had gone through all the land, they came to Jerusalem at the end of 9 months and 20 days. And Joab gave up the sum of the number of the people unto the king. And there were in Israel 800,000 valiant men that drew the sword, and the men of Judah were 500,000 men. So 500,000 plus 800,000 is 1,300,000. So there's our number. Now, in Chronicles, we aren't told how they numbered it or what their course was. They just number it, and we're given a very different number. It's like 1,580,000, something like that. But we're told how they numbered it here, what they did. Basically, if you look at the map in the back, I'm not going to put it on screen here, but if you look at the map, they went east, crossed Jordan, into Gad, Reuben, and Manasseh, and they numbered them, and they went up to the north, and then they came down on the west side, following Tyre and Zidon, and coming down into Judah on the south, and then came back up to Jerusalem. That's the journey they took in numbering Israel, and you know, in each place they went, they called Israel together, or they called the elders of the land to come and report how many battle-aged men were in Israel. This is counting for the military. Anyways, let us continue verse 10. And David's heart smote him after he had numbered the people. And David said unto the Lord, I have sinned greatly in that I have done. And now I beseech thee, O Lord, take away the iniquity of thy servant, for I have done very foolishly. For when David was up in the morning, the word of the Lord came unto the prophet Gad, David's seer, saying, Go and say unto David, Thus saith the Lord, I offer thee three things. Choose thee one of them, that I may do it unto thee. So Gad came to David and told him and said unto him, Shall 7 years of famine come unto thee in thy land? Or wilt thou flee 3 months before thine enemies while they pursue thee? Or that there be 3 days pestilence in the land? Now advise, and see what answer I shall return to him that sent me. And David said unto Gad, I am in a great strait. Let us fall now into the hand of the Lord, for his mercies are great, and let me not fall into the hand of man. So the Lord sent a pestilence upon Israel from the morning even to the time appointed, and there died of the people from Dan even to Beersheba 70,000 men. When the angel stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, the Lord repented him of the evil and said to the angel that destroyed the people, It is enough. Now stay thine hand. And the angel of the Lord was by the threshing place of Araunah the Jebusite. And David spake unto the Lord when he saw the angel that smote the people, and said, Lo, I have sinned, and I have done wickedly. But these sheep, what have they done? Let thine hand, I pray thee, be against me and against my father's house. So this is a little bit odd one, and if you might recall from 1 Chronicles, it kind of clarifies these points a little bit. So this is 7 years famine, or 3 months war, or 3 days pestilence. Being disease or those kind of that kind of stuff. Anyways, First Chronicles has it 3 years, 3 months, or 3 days, which makes a whole lot more sense. I think it probably was God saying 3, 3, and 3, and the author of Samuel just exaggerated the first one. But David says, "Let the hand of the Lord fall on me," but it doesn't clarify what that means because the hand of the Lord is in all of it, isn't it? Especially in the famine or the pestilence. War, you might say, yeah, God's just letting somebody else fall on me. But what's the difference between the famine and the pestilence? And that is clarified in 1 Chronicles, where it says, famine for 3 years, war for 3 months, or let the angel, or let the hand of the Lord fall on you through his angel to destroy through pestilence for 3 days. That's not a direct quote, but it's the idea. And that's why David says, let the hand of the Lord fall on me, and suddenly a pestilence comes. Now, we have this about the angel about to destroy Jerusalem, and then God repents and says, don't destroy Jerusalem. But that God repenting does not make sense. That is why I forgot to mention at the beginning, we have a Joseph Smith translation in this chapter. Well, the Joseph Smith translation is, this is an inspired translation or correction of the Bible, done by Joseph Smith to restore those passages that have been lost over the years. Now, in 2 Samuel chapter 24, we have a correction in the first verses 16 and 17. So let us reread this. We just read them. Let us read the Joseph Smith translation. And when the angel stretched out his hand upon Jerusalem to destroy it, the Lord said unto him, Stay now thine hand. It is enough, for the people repented, and the Lord stayed the hand of the angel, that he destroyed not the people. And the angel of the Lord was by the threshold of Araunah the Jebusite. For David spake unto the Lord when he saw the angel that smote the people, and said, Lo, I have sinned, and I have done wickedly. But these sheep, what have they done? Let thine hand, I pray thee, be against me and against my father's house. Now, verse 17 there has only the one alteration. Instead of starting with the word and, it starts with the word for. But we get this in verse 16, the very change. It wasn't God that repented, it was the people that repented, and so God said, okay, that's enough. They repented, we're good. But by changing the word and to for, what it is saying in the one thing, in the King James, it has that God repents and the destruction ends, and then David says this. But by the Joseph Smith translation corrects this so that David is saying this first, and that is what prompts God to say they have repented and the destruction is enough. So that is small but very significant change. Let us flip back here and let us read the rest of this. Verse 18. And Gad came that day to David and said unto him, Go up, rear an altar unto the Lord in the threshing floor of Araunah the Jebusite. And David, according to the saying of Gad, went up as the Lord commanded. And Araunah looked and saw the king and his servants coming on toward him. And Araunah went out and bowed himself before the king on his face upon the ground. And Araunah said, Wherefore is my lord the king come to his servant? And David said, To buy the threshing floor of thee, to build an altar unto the Lord, that the plague may be stayed from the people. And Araunah said unto David, Let my lord the king take and offer up what seemeth good unto him. Behold, here be oxen for burnt sacrifice, and threshing instruments, and other instruments for the oxen for wood. All these things did Araunah as a king give unto the king. And Araunah said unto the king, The Lord thy God accept thee. And the king said unto Araunah, Nay, but I will surely buy it of thee at a price. Neither will I offer burnt offerings unto the Lord my God of that which doth cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. And David built there an altar unto the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord was entreated for the land, and the plague was stayed from Israel. Now remember that in 1 Chronicles it says he paid, I think, 300 shekels for everything. I think the 50 shekels is what he paid for the land itself. Not the land, the 50 shekels would be for the oxen, and the rest of it's for the land. I don't know why they give different numbers there, but God tells him, build this altar. Why does he build it here? Because this is where he saw the angel. God said I was going to send an angel to destroy with a pestilence. David saw the angel, and God said, okay, you are asking me to end this. You want to end it? This is what you got to do. And so David builds the altar. He gives his sacrifice. One other thing to note about this is that it shows that these ordinances could be performed outside the temple, outside the tabernacle, as long as you had a proper authority to perform these sacrifices. The tabernacle was the center of worship, but there were other places dedicated to God where these ordinances could still be performed. Because remember, even at this time, the tabernacle is in Gibeah, but the ark is in Jerusalem. We got that also. The other thing I do want to point out, I think David was very right in refusing to accept the gift to make the sacrifice. He needed to pay for it. It's kind of like paying your tithing. That instead, you don't pay your tithing by asking somebody else to give you a gift so that you can pay tithing. You don't go to somebody and say, I need to pay tithing. So you give me some money so I can pay. You got to pay tithing with what you earned. And it's the same thing with the sacrifice. You don't sacrifice an animal that isn't yours. You got to pay for it first. Anyways, I'm going to leave that here, and I will see you in the next one.